first speaker is young Dr. Abhinav Biala. He's one of our new faculty at L.V. Prasad Eye Institute in Hyderabad, having done his fellowship in comprehensive as well as cataract and refractive surgery. And apart from that, being a very competent surgeon, he's also part of our education activities, as well as being an excellent cataract and refractive surgeon, and he's going to share his case. So I invite Abhinav to share his case.
Thank you, Dr. Sonshila, for the kind words.
Abhinav, I don't think you're loud enough.
So, is the audio better now?
Yeah, it's better. Just speak up, please.
Though. Yeah. So, my slides are visible, right?
Yes.
All right. So, good evening, everyone. At the outset, I would like to thank all India Ophthalmic Society Chairman, the Scientific Committee, for giving me this opportunity to present our case of this unhappy patient which we had. So, I have no financial disclosure. The patient was a 25-year-old male who came to us with diminution of vision in both the eyes. And he also had alopecia, for which he used steroids in the past for 10 months. On examination, he had this cataract, which was P3 on the LOX 3, and it was a steroid-induced cataract. It was there in both the eyes. Also, the patient was very learned. He had come to us with all the information about multifocal lenses, femtolaser-assisted cataract surgery, after reading up it on the internet. So, after all discussion with him, we decided to implant extended depth of focus lens. And on the A-scan, we saw he had significant astigmatism in both the eyes, which was with the root. We planned the right eye first. So, we also did a preoperative tomography to see whether the astigmatism findings were corroborating or not. And they were pretty much same on the tomography as well for the right eye. Then we fed in all the values in the Technis toric IOL calculator, and it gave us an IOL model of ZXT300, which was supposed to be implanted at 102 degrees in the right eye with a superior incision. So the intraoperative course was perfectly normal. We went ahead and did a manual marking both preoperatively as well as intraoperatively. On the first postoperative day, he had an unaided visual acuity of 20/30, with an unaided near vision of N8. But to our surprise, his visual acuity in the right eye had dropped to 20/60 at the end of 2 months of the surgery, with a significant residual refractive error, as you can see in my slide. In between, he had also undergone the left eye cataract surgery with the same Symphony toric IOL, which had a good refractive outcome. So then we went ahead and we started analyzing that what was the cause for that refractive error. So we did an eye trace and we saw that the eye trace showed that the IOL was slightly off axis and it required a little bit of rotation so as to have a good post-operative outcome. Similarly, we also got a post-operative tomography done so as to rule out if the surgically induced astigmatism or the incision was causing any significant astigmatism. But that was not the case, as the pre and the post-op values were almost the same. So finally, we dilated the patient and we saw that the IOL was definitely not at 102 degrees where we had intended it to be. And so we thought that what could have been the cause for this rotation. So very often, if we don't get the preoperative manual marking right, it can just lead to a downhill course with the intraoperative alignment also being wrong, because our preoperative manual marking is not accurate enough, as we use the Mendez ring to with the preoperative marking as the reference points. So any amount of viscoelastic which is left behind, suppose if it's not cleared off and before doing the final axis alignment, again is one of the causes. Also, intracameral antibiotic and wound hydration do raise some fluid waves in the anterior chamber, which can again lead to a slight shift in the final postoperative axis. So we took help of this calculator by Dr. Gurdal and et al., where you need to put in your postoperative refraction, and it tells you that by how much you need to rotate the lens. So this website also told, this calculator also told us that the IOL needed to be rotated by around 160 degrees to have a good post-operative outcome. So we took up the patient for surgery, for IOL redialing, and this time we took help of technology. We used the Callisto image-guided system, so as to have a post-operative axis at 102 degrees, as we had planned in the first surgery. At the end of 1 month of redialing, the patient did have a good visual outcome according to us, but he was not very happy with the fact that we were not able to get it right in the first surgery. So that's regarding my case.
No, Somsharam, we can't hear you.
Thank you very much, Abhinav, for presenting this case. The discussants for Dr. Abhinav's presentation will be Dr. Varman and Dr. Rajshekar. So I'll invite Dr. Varman to first give his comments or about this case.
Thank you, Somsheila. That was fantastic. Nice presentation that shows how you have to get it right the first go, particularly for toric IOLs. We couldn't really find out whether what was the cause of misalignment. I'm sure that the manual marking was accurate. So probably we have to put the blame on when you finally hydrate, you do a fluid wave, as the presenter said, and the back can inflate. And when the patient moves, it can rotate. But most often this rotation occurs in the first 6 to 8 hours. So it's kind of surprising that the patient was quite all right on the first post-op day, and the rotation took place later, which is surprising. That's a surprising part. So again, when you look at the microscope view, you really don't see much capsular fibrosis or anything that could have made the lens rotate. So we'll have to just think that the bag kind of inflated post-operatively, maybe a day, 2, 4, or 5 days later, because small amount of viscoelastic left on the posterior surface of the lens could have caused osmotic pulling in of fluid, and the bag would have inflated late in the post-operative period. And when the patient came back a month later, you've seen the surprise. The other issue is with these single-piece lenses, which are not plate-optic, when you want to rotate them anti-clockwise 20 degrees, you go around 150 degrees almost. That does make it a little difficult, and you need to really open up the bag fully and make sure that you use a good high-quality viscoelastic and you rotate it carefully by manual technique to get it perfectly aligned. And this time, make sure that you leave no viscoelastic behind.
So just wanted to share that I was the operating surgeon. This is my patient actually. So Abhinav was kind enough to be with me and support me. It was a very challenging patient to handle. He was very, very unhappy. So it was a perfectionist kind of patient. So Dr. Rajshekar, can we take your comments for this case?
Yeah, Dr. Arul Modi, he covered the technical part. Coming to the unhappiness part, you could have expected it from the beginning itself because it's a 25-year-old patient. Who is to start off itself, it's not the age for getting cataract, and the steroid induced element is there, and there is a kind of anti-doctor or anti-medicine mindset in him. And coming to toric lenses, I always tell that cylindrical power will reduce and it won't become zero, because you have a lot of limitations. The astigmatism correction you get only at 0.5 increments, and 102 degrees and 107 degrees are going to be different again. So it's best to set an expectation there. And most of the times, they should be, our optometry team has to be sensitized with regard to the AR readings. Autorefractor readings will go wrong in these cases. And if they see those, if you are, each time you are taking that printout to compare, again, you will end up with, basically it's a well-done surgery. Technically, you have used the best possible things, but patient is not happy because probably we have set his expectations wrong in this. So in toric lenses, setting expectations right and not playing to the gallery is extremely important. Just say that 1.75 cylinder will come down to 0.5 or whatever. That should be fine. And toric and multifocal is always a challenge.
Dr. Rajshekar, they are very, very valid points. Believe me, I set his expectations so low that I told him that you will get glasses post-op.
In India, that happens, ma'am. Because, see, whatever you are talking, they go by your reputation. they say that, oh ma'am, I say Kete, and finally she'll do well. And then they'll also say, we leave it to you, God is there. And finally, that means that you have to set it right. It's everything else is your headache. We find this.
So I think funnily, it was because the other I did so well. I think that contributed to his unhappiness.
Kunchila, can I just ask one question? You had a Callisto in the first instance.
Yes.
So why you did not use Callisto on the first instance only on the table?
So we have very high volume of cataract post-COVID. And each of us has our own OR, and sometimes very hard and very difficult to share the OR. This patient came at that particular time, and I would have to wait several hours for this kind of patient. So I was fairly confident because I'd really set his expectations so low, saying that come what may, you will need glasses. Because you know that symphony lens doesn't give a very good close-up vision, only intermediate. So I did my best, but for the left eye, it worked very well, not for the right eye. So it was a logistical reason that I couldn't use Callisto. And of course, now I've learned my lesson that always use it.
So one more thing, while we are, because at the Alcon session, I think Aura is a great tool also.
Yes, of course.
It gives you an intraop refraction, especially for toric IOLs, because it gives you an endpoint saying that no rotation is required. And only thing is that you will have to have a couple of lenses with you because you may have to change the lenses. So that kind of inventory is required. But it's a useful tool to have for toric lenses and also for post-refractive surgery cases.
Amit, how are we on time?
Callisto, no, like viewers shouldn't go with the impression that Callisto is a must for doing toric lenses. So you can do very well. In fact, for the second day, second surgery, they used Callisto and still patient is not happy. So, we'll introduce another parameter and confuse the patients. Same patient will come back and ask Somshila, why you didn't use it? That's why I'm unhappy. That will add to the problems. We introduce words and we'll add to our own problems.
I think always market our skills and not the instruments, I feel.
Yeah.
Aura or Callisto to the patient.
Tell the patient. That is for internal discussion.
Yeah, internal discussions.
For the patient. You never tell the patient what tools you are going to use. But then these are techniques and technology, which is, just helps to refine those things a little better.
Somshila, it's good to have unhappy patients so that doctors can always remain grounded.
but you don't have any, so you're the wrong person to say that. quick question for Abhinav, which I wanted to ask. Abhinav, since you analyzed this case of mine, would you now recommend that on the day one post-op also we should dilate and take a look at the axis? I think that is a good practice to have, but would you recommend that now?
I would not say on day one, but yeah, probably on day seven, it will be a good idea because the literature also reports that the rotation usually happens somewhere between week one to week three. So I think the first post-operative week, the day seven or the maybe the day 10 visit or probably day 14 visit will be a good, in case you don't see a good visual, uncorrected visual acuity, it will be a good idea to dilate and see the actual position.
I have a question for Dr. Weiler and Dr. Varman. If you see the first post-op day, lens is rotated, slightly rotated, say 5 degree to 10 degree. Will you take him immediately to the OR to rotate, redial it, or will you wait for a week?
Okay, I'll put it this way. I actually check every one of my patients immediate post-op before they leave home in a couple of hours after surgery. We look at if the pupil is still dilated, we try to see whether the lens is in position. That's the most critical point. You would find most of your rotations would occur at that point. If that occurs on day zero, I take the patient back to the OT right away. On day one, it ought not to have rotated. If it rotated day one, I'll go back to the OT again right away. But if it rotates after a week, then I'll probably wait 2 to 3 weeks for the back to shrink a little, then go for the re-rotation.
Okay. Dr. Weiler?
In my practice, I have kept little more tolerance limits. So we don't do immediate checkup of all these refractions on day one and day two and all that. We'll see the refraction. If it is within 0.25 to 0.5 cylindrical power, we just allow it there. It's because astigmatism is not bad, and even up to 0.75, we are not correcting. Then if you go on doing this fine tuning, you will introduce more parameters, risk of second surgeries, setting expectations further high and getting into issues. So that's why I just leave it at that. Like, you know, if a patient is having 0.89 astigmatism, which power you will choose? Where are you then? Again, you know, you'll have to go on this side or that side. So there is a tolerance limit. As long as you reduce the astigmatism, I think that should be good enough is my approach. We have rotated few lenses. That's because of the wrong marking that has happened in the preoperative. And intraoperative, you know, he specifically told you do a good washout, leave the AC tight. And each time you position the lens, you have to come clockwise. Suppose you have gone even 5 degrees clockwise, and then you try to adjust it by coming anti-clockwise, it doesn't work. Again, you have to come the clockwise because of the kind of the loops that are there. If you follow those techniques, mostly it will stay as you have left on the table. So you have to spend little extra time. All my surgeries toric take at least 5 to 10 minutes extra time because you have to be that patient to wash out the visco and put it position right and keep the AC tight. It will work that way. And we mark the axis at which we have to put the lens. We don't go at 180 degrees and again put another, because you will be introducing two more parameters. Pre-op, you mark where exactly you have to put and align the lens and leave it at that.
Thank you very much.
Somehow it's working.
I would just like to pitch in and just highlight three intraoperative points that are very essential. I think very rightly said, tapping the lens is very important, washing the viscoelastic behind the lens, and not overinflating, because the moment the back gets overinflated, there are more chances of lens getting rotated. So I think an average hydration is what is important, and overhydration should be avoided. And secondly, any refraction day one, if you have a combination of plus and minus, that always indicates that yes, the lens has rotated. And you don't need high gadgets. I think the software on the internet, the astigmaticfix.com, gives you a fair idea, you know, how to chip in and how to correct. And day one is the most important day where you should look in. I mean, immediate post-op is the maximum rotation that occurs, I think. So very rightly said by Dr. Verman, we should immediately, you know, after the surgery, after 2-3 hours, take a slit lamp examination. And that gives us, because early rotation most commonly occurs within half an hour. The moment you shift the patient out, that is the time when the rotation occurs. Somshila, all yours.
Yeah, so it's a very interesting case, but we have so many more interesting ones coming up. Moving on to the second presentation, I'd like to, before that, thank Dr. Rajshekhar, Dr. Verman, and thank you, Abhinav, for presenting my case.